Let's bow our head, please. Loving Father, as we open your word and as we share today, we ask for you to bring your spirit upon each of our hearts to draw very near to each one of us. And we'll give you the glory in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. How many remember, it's been a couple years or so ago, that on Vespers, we had what we called a testimony sharing time. Does anybody remember that? Okay, I know that a allotted amount of time would be given to different ones, and they would tell some of the experiences, some of their stories. Some were conversion stories and how God had blessed. And that was a wonderful thing. And Brother Ray, I especially enjoy Brother Ray's stories, his testimony. Believe me, he's got some real stories to tell of how God has worked in his life. So I think it would be good if this church, if we could have that happen again sometime. But I didn't get to share anything during that time, and I thought, if it's okay with you, rather than preaching the sermon, I would like to share with you my conversion story. Now, you know the purpose of conversion stories is not to glorify oneself, but it is to demonstrate the power of God in transforming sinners into Christians. Well, as I thought about my story, I began with a title. Now, I began searching in my mind what would be an appropriate title for my story. I thought of some really good-sounding titles, for an example, From Drug Lord to Seventh-day Adventist Preacher. From Gang Member to Preacher. That's a good one. From Rock Star to the Pulpit. They're all good, but I couldn't use any of them. For you see, I've never been a drug lord or a gang member, and I certainly have never been a rock star. So the very bottom line is this. I've never done anything outstandingly secular or bad that I could take a little sinful glory in. I meant to say that I could use to really demonstrate the power of God in changing my life. None of those things has happened with me. The fact is that my life has been what might be described as boring, mundane, commonplace, just plain old ordinary. But I finally settled on a title for my talk. I entitled this talk, My Testimony. Amen? All right. Now, you know, everybody has a testimony. You have a testimony. And it takes as much power for God to convert a mundane, commonplace sinner as it does a drug lord or a high-profile criminal. It takes just as much power. For you see, no matter what your status in life is, the human heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked, and who can know it? Now, those are the words of Jeremiah in chapter 17 and verse 19. I invite you to take your Bible and turn to Revelation chapter 12. That was our memory verse. Revelation chapter 12. But we're only going to read verses 10 through 11 again. Revelation 12, verses 10 through 11. That's an easy one, should be quick to find. And I heard a loud voice in heaven saying in heaven, now has come salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ. For the accuser of our brethren is cast down, which accused them before our God day and night. The one I want to point you to is the next verse. And they overcame him by what way does it say? By the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they loved not their lives unto the death. Now, speaking of the same thing along the same line, you don't need to turn, just jot it down. Malachi 3, verse 16 says, then they that feared the Lord spake often one to another. Isn't that beautiful? And the Lord hearkened and heard it. And a book of remembrance was written before him for them that feared the Lord and that thought upon his name. In other words, they were sharing with one another the mighty workings of God in their lives. And thus they were encouraging one another. And that's what I want to do this morning. I want to share the mighty workings of God in my experience. Well, let me get started. My introduction to the Seventh-day Adventist Church, to the importance of keeping all of God's commandments, began with a severe case of yellow jaundice. Anybody know what yellow jaundice is? I expect to see our nurse's hand go up. Well, it wasn't me that had it. It was my sister. Let me tell you about my sister. She got sick, yellow jaundice, and she went to a Greenville, Tennessee hospital that happened to be a Seventh-day hospital. She didn't know anything about Seventh-day Adventists. None in our family had ever heard of Seventh-day Adventists, but she got sick and she went there. And while she was in there, the cook of the hospital came by her room every day, and sometimes he would read from the scriptures, but he would always have prayer with her. Well, that impressed my sister, but she got well, she went back home, and shortly after she got home, her husband came down with yellow jaundice. And yes, he went to the Greenville Seventh-day Adventist Hospital, and while he was there, that same cook, his name was Brother Brainerd. I remember that name and will to the day of my death, because that man was very instrumental in my being a Seventh-day Adventist. Brother Brainerd went by his room every day and shared with him and had prayer with him. And then he got well and went home, and Brother Brainerd drove over 30 miles every week to study the Bible with them. And they became a Seventh-day Adventist. And you don't know my sister, but I want to tell you, she can get excited at times. And she had a real experience with the Lord. And she was just bubbling over with it. And she couldn't keep it to herself. Now why? Isaiah chapter 43, verse 10, write it down. It says, you are my witnesses, saith the Lord. Mark chapter 16, 15, and he said unto them, go you into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. If you have had a true, genuine experience with Jesus Christ, your heart is going to burn, and you will not be able to help yourself. You are going to start witnessing and telling others what he has done for you. Can I hear an amen? Amen. Well, my sister began her witness primarily with my father. Now let me tell you about my daddy. My daddy was a very secular man. I don't believe he had ever set foot one day in church in his life. He had absolutely nothing to do with religion. I never heard him talk about religion or talk about God. And I will never forget it. We were living in Rocky Holler, Tennessee. And that's back there nestled in the hills of East Tennessee. And it indeed was a Rocky Holler, dirt road weaving through those hills there in East Tennessee. And so I remember well, my dad was in the living room standing up, the front door open, my sister came in, and with tears running down her eyes, she walked up to my father, and she threw her arms around him weeping, and she begged him. She told him Jesus was coming, and she begged him to give his heart to the Lord. It turned my father off. For the long, long time, she was not allowed back in her home. From that time on, my dad, although he knew nothing about Seventh-day Adventists, knowing that she was one, from that moment on, there was a hatred in his heart for the Seventh-day Adventist church. And whenever he used the word Seventh-day Adventist, he would never call it that. He would use the word Seventh-day Advances. But my sister also, early on, she witnessed to my mother, and she witnessed to me. I wish I could describe, I wish I had the words that would allow me to tell you the effect that hearing this message had upon my young life. I was a young teenager at this time. And I would go to her home for maybe a week or two at a time, and she would tell me about how that Jesus was coming back. She told me about the Seventh-day Sabbath and the state of the dead. And I want to tell you that I have never experienced such emotions before, but it almost seemed like that during that time that I could almost reach out and touch heaven. I could almost feel the presence of angels. My heart was beginning to burn. Now, I went to school. I would stay all night with her, catch a school bus at her place out in the country. And I can remember she gave me a copy of Desire of Ages. And I can remember hiding that book, Desire of Ages, in front of my textbooks. I never was a real good student. And I'd read from that book, Desire of Ages. I had a good friend, and I started talking to him about it, about what I was learning. And he and I would get into debates concerning the Sabbath. And neither one of us knew a thing about what we were talking about. But I was so turned on, and I was so excited. I knew that Jesus was coming very soon. And to show you how stupid I was, in my excitement and in my belief that he's coming back immediately, I made a bet with him. I bet him $25 that the Lord would return before the year of 1975. And this was around 1956 or 7 that we were talking. It didn't dawn on me that if he won the bet, I could never collect from him. But if I lost, I was going to have to pay up. I've been in communication with that friend. He still lives back there in East Tennessee. And I'm telling you right now, I've never mentioned it to him, and I don't have any intentions. He forgot about it, and I'm going to leave well enough alone. But I was excited about what I was hearing. My sister told me that we needed to be careful about what we took into our mind. And she talked about the evils of the theater world. And it so happened that we called them, there was a theater in Jonesboro. I lived about 5 miles out of Jonesboro. And there was a theater there. We called it The Show. And it was our practice. Every Saturday afternoon, my dad would say to us kids, load up. Me and my younger brother and older brother would pile in the car, and he would take us into Jonesboro. And while he was taking care of other business, he gave us money, and we would go to the show. And how I loved that. I learned all about Tarzan and things like that. But I came under strong conviction now that I shouldn't be going to the show anymore. Remember, I was just a kid. And so Sabbath came Saturday afternoon. My dad said, load up. And I made an excuse for not going. I was not feeling well. And so they went without me. Next Saturday came, load up. I made another excuse for not going. They went without me. The third week in a row, my dad said, load up. And I made another excuse. And my dad said, whoa, what's going on here? I didn't have the backbone to go against my father. Contrary to those stories of people who go against their parents in order to follow the Lord and are kicked out of their home and some beaten, I've always admired those people, but I wasn't one of them. I loaded up and I went to the show. And you know, from that time on, I lost it altogether, that experience I had. I turned my back on the life that I had received. And I kept on loading up and going to the show. But after that, I never could quite fully enjoy sitting there again. Because as I sat there, I kept thinking, what if Jesus were to come while I'm in this show? Well, a few years later, a few years went by. At the age of 17, I went further away from God by joining the Golden Gloves Boxing Club there in Johnson City. I said that I went further away from God by doing that because boxing gloves and Christianity are not congruent with each other. Can you picture Jesus Christ with a pair of boxing gloves? No. Well, that year that I joined, the year of 1959, I got lucky and I won the Upper East Tennessee Golden Gloves Light Heavyweight Championship, and I thought that I'm on my way. I have found my calling in life. So I thought. Now, I said I got lucky because as I look back on that experience, I really wasn't all that good. I had only had 1 year of actual training and only a total of just 5 actual bouts in the ring, and that hardly constitutes one being called a boxer. I probably won that championship title because that particular year my competitors were all worse than I was. But be that as it may, the sports writers who like to really blow things up, they were predicting in the newspaper that Carol Graybill was the one that everybody should keep their eye on during the next boxing season as being the most promising and upcoming fighter. Wow. Well, the only thing that really got blowed up was my head. I praise the Lord that the next boxing season came, but it never came for me. I'll tell you why shortly. You see, I had turned my back on God and the life that He had given me, but God did not turn His back on me. Can I hear an amen? Have you ever heard of Pharisaical Christians? Did you know every church has a Pharisaical Christian? Not every church. But where else would you find Pharisaical Christians but in church? Well, a Pharisaical Christian, if they could have known what I did by rejecting that life, they would have closed the door of probation on me right then. For you see, Pharisaical Christians cannot identify with Jeremiah 31 and verse 3, which says, listen to this, "The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love. Therefore, with loving kindness have I drawn thee." Isn't that beautiful? That's God. That's the God that we serve. Well, you see, back then, the gospel seed had been planted in my heart at a young age, but it took several years, at least a few years, for that seed to spring up and bear fruit. But even though it was lying dormant in my heart during those years, that seed, nevertheless, it continued to influence decisions in my life for the good. Some of you have heard me tell the story. It was on a Halloween night, and some of us country boys out there in the area of Rocky Holler, Tennessee, were roaming those country roads looking for mischief to get into. And someone pulled out a whiskey bottle, of all things, and they began to pass it around. That was my younger brother Jimmy's first experience with alcohol. And may I say that it practically ruined his life. When that bottle came to me, I handed it over to the next one. Praise the Lord. I had the backbone then to go against the majority, and I said, no, I'm not going to do it. I contribute my choice not to drink that night to the seed that had been planted in my heart. Wow. Now, during this time, while the gospel seed was lying dormant, the devil was working hard to keep it that way. 1 Peter 5:8 says, "Be sober, be vigilant, because your adversary, the devil, as a roaring lion, walketh about seeking whom he may devour." I believe with all my heart that one of the tools the devil used in trying to keep me turned away from that light I had been given, I believe it was my dad's abnormal hatred for the Seventh-day Adventist Church. Let me tell you a little bit about my dad. My dad was a wonderful father. I mean, he would go for 2 or 3 months at a time, and he would just be a wonderful father. Nothing to do with religion at all, though. And then for some reason, and we don't know what it was, my siblings and I and my mother, as we've looked back, we never could figure out what caused it. But every 2 or 3 months, he would go on a binge. And we're not sure if he was getting a hold of moonshine, which it very well might have been, because that was the thing back there in those hills where I live. But my dad would change his character. He would come home and he would start berating my mother. he would accuse her of infidelity, of something that would never have happened. And my brothers and I knew that was not happening. And he would bring up those 7-day advances. And I remember one night in particular, my father came home and he fell down on the floor in front of us, and he rolled over on the floor, and he said, "Now, kids," he said, "this is what those 7-day advances do. They hoop and they holler. You don't ever want to have anything to do with those 7-day advances." I can remember many a night when my father was in one of those times. He would be away and I knew he was going to come home. I can remember many a night laying in bed in a cold sweat, dreading to hear that car drive up in the highway in our parking lot. And I can remember many a time of not going out and doing things that the other teenagers were doing because I was afraid to leave my mother, because he was in one of those times in his life. And I remember on a couple of occasions where we had to, when he was gone, we would go hide. We ran to our neighbors on one occasion. And one time when we were waiting for him to come back and we were trying to get away before he got there, I put a hunting knife in my belt. And I told myself that if it becomes necessary, I would use that knife. A horrible, horrible feeling for any young man to have, especially a young man who loved his father. If the devil was using my father in this way to keep me from away from the light that I had received, it backfired. Before that next boxing season started, I had gotten married and started a home of my own away from the anti-Seventh-day Adventist influence of my father. And when I moved out on my own, the Spirit of God almost immediately began moving on my heart, and it reminded me of the light I had been given and the joy that I had experienced from that light. And then when that happened, any possibilities for a boxing career, if indeed ever there was one, which I seriously doubt, we had ended right then. For you see, I asked the Seventh-day Adventist minister in Johnson City, Tennessee, to come to my home and give me Bible studies. And he did, every Friday night without fail. And when my dad found out about it, he became extremely angry, and he said, "If those 7-day advances ever get Carol, I'm going to blow up the church." Now, you know, if that was this time in which we live, he probably would have gone to prison for terroristic threatening. They got me. I was baptized, and my dad did not blow up the church. And right after I was baptized, the Spirit of God was on me. And you know, Jesus said, "You're the light of the world." And I began to witness as well. A tent meeting, Elder J.J. Miette, an evangelist from Louisiana, came. A big tent was erected in Johnson City, Tennessee. And I took my mother, unbeknownst to my father, to those meetings. And at the end of it, a call was made to those who wanted to be baptized to come forward. My mother got up and went forward. The next morning, she told my father she was going to be baptized. My dad took a knife and he cut up all her dresses so she would have nothing to wear to be baptized in. He threw her Bible in the stove and burned it up. He got out his 16-gauge shotgun and pointed it at her. He was threatening to kill her if she were to be baptized. I thank God that he didn't pull that trigger. He settled down and he went off to work. My mother got a hold of my sister living in Kingsport, Tennessee. And she came and picked my mother up. And that Kingsport church took my mother and they hid her from house to house until they could take up enough money to send her out to Seattle, Washington, where she had an unmarried sister living. This was a time of darkness for my mother. She had no idea what the future held, but she remained faithful to her convictions, and she moved 3,000 miles away from her children in the area where she had basically lived all her life. You know, I don't know why it is. Well, I do know. This story is making me a little emotional. Tomorrow is Mother's Day. In telling this story of my mother, I wish to pay tribute to her faithfulness. And not only to her, but to faithful mothers everywhere. You know, she had no idea what was going to happen to her, but there was someone who did know. In Romans 8:28, we know that all things work together for good to them. If you know it, say it out loud. To them that love God, to them who are called according to his purpose. While living in Seattle with her sister, a Seventh-day Adventist minister came and studied with both of them, and they were baptized together. Amen. Now, meanwhile, going back to East Tennessee and my father, in the meanwhile, divorced my mother, and as my siblings and myself suspect, he burned down his nice house in Jonesboro, Tennessee, that was paid for, and he collected the insurance on it. And we know that he burned it down because the only thing that escaped that fire was his favorite thing, and that was a 16-gauge shotgun that happened to be in his car. After being away for 2 years, my mother, who still loved my father, came back home. And they were remarried. And they lived together till my dad died. And during that time, he no longer opposed. He allowed my mother to practice her religion, never opposed her again. Now, he never did join the church, but before he died, he allowed me to have prayer with him. Wow. I don't know about my dad. I like to think that he's going to be saved too. A big miracle in my testimony is that God took me, an uneducated, in the rough, stumbling, bumbling Tennessee hillbilly boy, and has for 58 years used me in different areas of his service. All of which I was totally unqualified for. And by the way, serving as a lay pastor is one of those services that I was unqualified for. But I thank God that I've got Judy to help me. And as you are well aware, Judy and I, as pastor here, we work together. We give Bible studies together. We do everything together. And I'm going to confess, I suspect that she is the stronger side of our working union. Now, I wish that I could tell you that during the last 58 years of serving God in the Seventh-day Adventist Church, that I've always been faithful, but that would be a lie, not true. But I can tell you this. I can tell you that God has always forgiven and restored me back into His graces when I fell far short of His glory, and that's been many, many times. And now, miracle of miracles is, here I am, and I'm still searching for a deeper walk with Him. Are you searching for a deeper walk with the Lord? I've got a scripture I want you to turn to, and then I'm going to sit down. It's found in 1 Corinthians 4 and verse 8. And by the way, I came across this minister a few weeks ago up at the ministerial workers meeting in Little Rock. I was so impressed with it that I've jotted it. I've committed it to my memory. It is 2 Corinthians. I told you first. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, and I want you to look at verses 8 and 9. Are you there? Amen. We are troubled on every side, yet not distressed. Isn't that beautiful? You may have all kinds of difficulties facing you. You may even have had a diagnosis. You got a terminal disease. Anything. But you don't have to be distressed. We are perplexed, but not in despair. Persecuted, but not forsaken. Cast down, but not destroyed. Can I hear an amen? Amen? You know, I'm making this scripture, I don't know if this is the right way, the watchword of my life. A day does not go by but what I quote this beautiful promise. And I want to tell you, I am experiencing its fulfillment. I'm finding that I've got peace. You know, we are supposed to have a perfect peace that passes understanding. That all comes by faith, doesn't it? By believing. It is my prayer that everyone in here will find that experience of this promise in your own lives. May God bless you. Song leaders, would you come up as we do our closing song? And that page is 554, Oh, Let Me Walk With Thee. And as you sing this song, may this be a prayer of each one of our hearts as well. Page 555. Shall we stand? It's not 555.
554.
554, I'm sorry.
Oh, let me walk with Thee, my God, as Enoch dwelt in days of old. Place Thou Thy trembling hand in Thy
Could we pause there for just a moment? As we sing these last two verses, if there is someone here this morning and you know your walk is not where it should be, and you want the peace offered in 2 Corinthians 4, verses 8 and 9, you want to renew your experience with Jesus Christ, you want to rededicate your life to Him, I would invite you to walk on down, and we will especially remember you in our closing prayer. Let's sing the next two verses.
I cannot dare not walk alone. The tempest rages in the storm sky. A thousand snares beset my feet. A thousand foes are lurking nigh. Still the raging of the sea. O Master, let me walk with Thee. If I may rest my hand in Thine, I'll count the joy.
Let us pray, loving Father, in a special way, we want to lift up those who came forward in a rededication of their life to you, a renewal of their experience, a renewal of their walk with you, whatever their reason for coming forward. We pray that you will honor that, God, and give them that which they have desired this morning. And now with every eye closed, if there should be one person here maybe, or someone, and you know that you really should have come, whatever reason you didn't, but you too would like to be included in this closing prayer, just lift your hand wherever you are. God, yes, amen, amen, amen. God sees your hand. Is there another? Yes, God sees your hand. Our Father, you've seen the uplifted hands. We include them and pray that you will give them that which they need as well. And now, God bless each one of us here this morning. We pray that our walk with you, every one of us, our walk with you will be renewed, and that you will bless the testimony of our lives to your glory. Because we ask it in Jesus' name. Amen. God bless you. You may be seated. Our deacons will usher you out.